Hello everyone. If you work on backend API server or any frontend client that communicates with a backend server, you probably know how extensively JSON data format is used to communicate between server and client. In this lesson, we are going to talk about handling JSON data format with Go. So let's dive in. First, let us look at marshaling and unmarshaling of JSON data. In Go, the process of converting Go data structures like structs, maps, and slices into JSON data is called marshaling. On the other hand, the process of converting JSON data back into Go structs, maps, or slices is called unmarshaling. The standard library package encoding/json provides the functions marshal and unmarshal to perform these operations. Although Go provides support for automatically marshaling basic data types like strings, numbers, booleans, etc., it is highly advised to use JSON tags. What exactly are JSON tags? JSON tags are used to map how struct fields are marshaled and unmarshaled, or to form a mapping between the struct field and the JSON data object field. JSON tags are added inside backticks to the end of struct field declaration. It should be on the same line as the struct field. Inside the tag, you provide mapping to JSON field name and other options. These options are provided in a comma-separated string. Let us look at some common JSON tags. One of the widely used JSON tag is omitEmpty. It is used to mark that the struct field is excluded when the zero value for the field is provided. So, if you have the struct field set to the zero value for the data type, it will be omitted. Then we have the dash. It is used to indicate that the field should be completely ignored from the marshaled JSON data. There are some other reasons why JSON tags are highly recommended. Let us look at them. By default, field name in Go struct must match exactly with the JSON keys or the JSON field names in the JSON object. The mapping is case sensitive. If you remember, Go uses cases to determine if an entity is exported or not from the package it is defined in. Similar is the case for fields in structs. If the field name starts with an uppercase letter, then it is exported. Otherwise, it is unexported. JSON marshaling and unmarshaling through marshal and unmarshal functions require the fields inside the struct to be exported. So, it requires the fields to start with uppercase letter, which may not match with the field name of your JSON data object. So, it's highly recommended to always use JSON tag for clarity of code and to know how the fields in your structs are mapped to the JSON data object. Now we have talked a lot about marshaling. Let us look at some examples. Here in package main, let me first create a JSON data object that we are going to use for this example. So this here is our JSON data. It has user ID, which is a number, name, which is a string, age, again a number, password, which is a string, and then roles, which is a string array. Now, we want to map it to a Go struct. Let us do that. I'm going to create a structure to map this JSON object. So, in user struct, I would like to map the user ID that we have here with ID in the field. So, I can do ID and say int. Then, this is how you add tags. So, inside the backticks, I can say JSON. And then, I need to have quotes. The field I am mapping it to is user ID. So I can say user ID, which means in the Go world, it will be referred to as ID, but when marshaled to JSON, it will be user ID. Similarly, I can do this for rest of the fields. So here we have created the mapping for all the fields in JSON data to our user struct in Go. ID is mapped to user ID, name is mapped to name, age is mapped to age, and permissions to roles. So as you can see, we can use JSON tags for mapping. We are mapping roles to permissions in Go. And if you remember, I'm using option dash, which is to omit the password whenever we are marshaling data. Now here, I have also used omitEmptyMap to let Go know that whenever name is empty, please omit it from the marshaled data or marshaled JSON data. With our mapping done, let's move on to marshaling the Go struct or the user into JSON data. First, let us create a user struct. Give it an ID of 1, name user 1, age 20, password, my password. Permission, we want it to be a string array. So we will use a string slice here and say admin and group member. Now we have the user created. Let us marshal this with json.marshal. So it will give us byte data. Let us store that in B. And if there's any error, we store that in error. json.marshal and provide the user data. If there's any error, we just print the error and panic. Now let's use our Marshal data or the byte data to print a string which has the JSON data. So I will do string conversion and provide the byte slice. So as you can see, what we are doing is we are using the struct which has JSON tags for mapping each field of the struct into JSON field. And then we are creating a instance of user then using JSON Marshal, which accepts an argument of any and returns a byte array or an error. And then we are just printing the marshaled JSON data. Now let's run our program to verify the behavior. And as you can see, we have successfully marshaled our struct of user into a JSON data object. User ID, which is mapped to ID, name, which is mapped to name, age, and role. As you can see, the password has been completely omitted because we provided a dash, an option to omit it from JSON marshaling. For name, we added the option to omit empty. As you can see, first we had the field name and then comma separated the option. What that means is, so if we provided an empty string into name, we will see that name is omitted from the Marshal data. And as you can see, name is omitted. But if it's not empty, then we run our program again. You can see name was added. I will provide you a link to the docs for Marshal so that you can use other options available if you need to. So just to recap, marshaling is marshaling a Go struct into JSON data. Now let's look at unmarshaling. Let's remove everything we have here and use a new example just for practice. Let me create a structure here called person. As you can see, we have a struct called person which has a name field mapped to JSON full underscore name, age, which is years underscore old with omit empty option, and then occupation, which has a dash that is completely omitted, and languages, which is mapped to spoken languages and is a string array. Now inside the main, let's first create a JSON data. Here, JSON data is just a string which holds a JSON data. Next, let us create a variable of type person. Now let us use the unmarshal function from encoding slash JSON to unmarshal JSON data that we have here into our person struct. And as you can see, it accepts a byte of JSON data, then the target in which the data will be populated, and returns the error if there's any. So first we need to convert the string into byte. We can do this. And then a pointer to our target struct, which is person in this case. And if there's an error, we just print the error and panic. If everything worked fine, let us print the fields of person now, which should be populated when we did unmarshal. Here, I have added some print statements to get the fields from the unmarshaled data. Let's run our program to see what happens. Go run main.go. And as you can see, we were able to get name, age, languages from our person struct after the data or the JSON data was unmarshaled into person. Since occupation has a dash option, which means we don't unmarshal it at all. As such, the occupation was skipped. So that's how you perform marshaling and unmarshaling of JSON data. Now let's move on to JSON encoding and decoding. In one of the previous lessons, we talked about io.reader and io.writer interfaces and how they are used to read or write byte data. For example, pointer to HTTP request and HTTP response writer implements io.reader and io.writer interfaces respectively. I'm talking about this because when we encode and decode JSON data, most of the time it has to be done with the HTTP request or the HTTP response writer. So wouldn't it be more efficient if instead of using byte slice as an intermediary, we could directly marshal or unmarshal JSON data from io.reader and io.writer? This is where JSON encoding and decoding comes into play. You can create a new JSON encoder with a stream like a file, io.writer or byte slice, etc., which will be the destination for the encoder. Similarly, the encoding JSON decoder supports various inputs like byte slices, readers, io.reader, and more. This way, we can create an encoder decoder with a destination or a source and then directly encode or decode our JSON data. It is better understood with an example. So let's have a look at one. So here I will create a new type person with different fields. Here I have created a person struct with name, age and active fields. The name is mapped to username, age is mapped to age, and active is mapped to is active. Inside our main, let us create an instance of person. We can say p person name ls age 25 and active set to true. Now we have a person created. Now let's create a iWriter. I will use a file. So os.createOutput.json. So here we create a file which implements io.writer. If there's an error, we just print the error and we will then panic. Otherwise, we will just defer the closing of the open file. Now let's create an encoder from the iWriter or the file. To create an encoder, you can just do encoder colon equal json dot new encoder which accepts a io.writer which our file implements, so we can provide it, and then we have a new encoder created. Now let's encode our person struct field. Here what we are doing is we are just calling encode on encoder which returns the error. So we check for the error. If there's an error, we panic. Now this simple program is creating a file and then using the encoder or new encoder to create an encoder from the file which implements io.writer, and then we call the encoder with our struct that has JSON tags to encode the struct data into a JSON file. Let's run our program. And as you can see, output.json has been created. And inside it, we have the JSON data. So instead of us marshaling and creating a byte slice from it and then encoding it into the output.json file, we can simply use the encoder to encode it directly. Now let us look at the opposite, which is decoding from JSON data. Now I have modified our code in main to do the opposite. First, we just create a person variable, which is uninitialized. Then we created a file by calling os.open on our existing file. If there's an error, we panic. Otherwise, we defer the closing of file. So instead of creating an encoder, we created a decoder here by calling json.newDecoder and passing file which also implements io.reader. In the next step, we use the decoder to decode the data provided by io.reader into the target pointer or a pointer to person. If there's an error, we print the error. Otherwise, we will just print the person struct. Let's now run our program again to verify the behavior. And as you can see, we were able to directly decode the JSON data into our person struct using the new decoder providing the file which implements io.reader. So encoder and decoder are much more efficient when you are dealing with io.reader or io.writer, which is the case for http.request and http.responseWriter. That's it for this lesson. Let's now summarize everything we have learned in this lesson. We saw Go provides first-class support to work with JSON data through the standard lib package encoding/json. Then we looked at various functions that implement Marshaler, Unmarshal, Encoder, Decoder interfaces, etc. that can be used to work with JSON data and Go data structures, as we saw in our example. We also looked at JSON tags and how tags are very helpful in defining the mapping between fields of data structures or our structures in Go code and their JSON field counterparts. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. Until next time, happy coding.